Good morning, dear brothers and sisters. We welcome you once again for this morning service that's going online and FB and YouTube. I believe that you would have been blessed all these past weeks being with us in these services, and I believe the Lord would have challenged you. The Lord would have done many miracles in your lives. I believe you have a lot to praise the Lord, to give glory to the Lord. So once again, we are here to sing unto the Lord, to give glory to the Lord, to listen to His message. And we know, we are sure that the Lord will bless you too. So let's sing this morning. As our first hymn, it goes, "Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me." We were in the world once, we were lost once, but now we are found. So we can give glory to the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word, my hope secures. He held my shield and portioned me as long. Chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. Shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbid to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy raised unending love. Amazing grace, unending love, amazing grace.
Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for amazing grace, Lord, oh Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for saving us through the precious blood, Lord. Lord, we are so privileged to be called your children, and you gave us the sonship, Lord, oh Master. We thank you, Lord, oh Father, Lord. Lord, we were chained, Lord, oh Father. We were slaves, Lord, oh Master, because of you. Because of, Lord, your salvation, Lord, oh Father, that you have given us, Lord, oh Father. We could stand here and give you glory, Lord. Give you honor. Give you praises, Lord, oh Father. Hallelujah. We bless your holy name. Hallelujah. Lord, we love you this morning, Lord, oh Father. We want to sing unto you, Lord, oh Father. We want to give you glory, honor, and praise, Lord, oh Father. May your name be glorified and magnified, Lord, oh Master. Hallelujah. Lord, I pray that you'll touch the people who are watching, Lord, oh Father. Even as they give glory unto you, Lord, oh Father. Lord, I pray, Lord, oh Master. Lord, you'll do something new this morning, Lord, oh Master. Thank you, Lord, oh Father. We give you glory. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you. Father in heaven, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people declare your mighty works, blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore.
Father in heaven, Father in heaven, how we love you.
Yes, Lord.
We'll lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people declare your mighty words, blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore.
I want to lift your name.
I want to lift your name on high.
Oh yes, Lord.
I choose to lift your name on high. I'll lift your name like a banner in the sky. I want to lift your name on high. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns who reigns forevermore, who reigns forevermore.
Yes, Lord, we bless your holy name. Lord, you are everything, Lord, Master. You are both great and small, Lord, Master. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We give you glory, Lord, Master. We give you honor. What a wonderful God we serve. You are the great and mighty God. Oh, the wonderful Savior are you. Wonderful Savior are you. We bless your holy name. You are so wonderful, Master. Hallelujah. Bless you, Lord Jesus. We love you, Lord Jesus. We give you glory and honor, Lord Jesus.
Dear friends, welcome to online service today, the first Sunday of July. Now it's wonderful to speak the Word of God, which has been spoken for millenniums, centuries, and now decades. You know, God's Word is so wonderful. It, you know, envelopes every kind of situation and person and character. I'm going to speak to you about a character, about a person that the Word of God has, you know, set apart 42 chapters for him, all around one character, one person. And the man is Job. There are 42 chapters. From the beginning to the end, it's to do with Job and what happened to him. You know, this is the concern of God, the love of God, you know, what he treasures in you. Now, we'll read in chapter 1 these words about him. Job chapter 1 says, "There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was blameless, upright, one who feared God and shunned evil." You know, what a wonderful introduction to the man. Then look at the second verse. "And 7 sons and 3 daughters were born to him. Also his possession were 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys, and a very large household, so that this man was the greatest of all the people of the East." Why is God treasuring this man? In today's language, you will call him a billionaire or even a trillionaire. I mean, there's nothing wrong with wealth, except in one thing, that people, when they get wealth, something happens to their character. They will go for the second wife, the third wife. They are not satisfied with this. Even whatever mansion they have, they want more and more. And, you know, and thereby, the value of them within deteriorates, that goes down, and their bank balances and businesses increase. So you can see what God treasures in anyone. It says we brought nothing into this world, and it's sure that we will not take anything out. We came naked, we had to go naked. But when man understands who God is and his nature, his character, it says yesterday, today, and forever, Jesus remains the same. There is no turning, change, you know, shadow of turning with him. So what is most valuable about any person is their inmost being, their nature, their character, not so much the material things. The Bible says in the book of Proverbs, a good name is better than rubies. You know, people will love you. So, coming to the last chapter of the story, chapter 42, you know, he lost all that wealth in one day. All 10 children died. All his wealth was stolen or burned. Everything was gone. I mean, you will either kill yourself if you didn't have inner character or a hope within you, or you will, you know, take poison or go off your mind, or something will happen. But this man remained intact and said, the Lord has given and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Others in our part of the world will say that some charm or some kind of evil spell has been put on us. Now, that's 100% right, because this came through some evil spirits, a demonic attack, a satanic attack on the man because of jealousy, because he was a possessed treasure of God. Now, he didn't change. After that, he lost his health. So then some friends of his came to console him, and later on they became miserable friends because they were trying to scrutinize some hidden inner secret or sin of this man. He had nothing. He was an honest man. Anyway, from chapter 38, 39, 40 and 41, God speaks in all those four chapters. He rebukes their folly, the things they said. You know, most of the time we sin through our mouths, our lips. We talk about things we know, we talk about things we don't know. Anyway, in the last chapter, I'm going to read those few verses to you from verses 1 to 6. It says, then Job answered the Lord and said, I know that you can do everything, and that no purpose of yours can be withheld from you. You asked, who is this who hide counsel without knowledge? Therefore I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me, which I did not know. Listen, please, and let me speak. You said, I will question you, and you shall answer me. I have heard of you by my hearing of the ear, but now my eyes sees you. Therefore I abhor myself, and I repent in dust and ashes. So those were the final words that Job spoke to the Lord after he questioned him about his so-called knowledge. Today we have people who are called scientists and brilliant people with a few PhDs, and they have proven that there is no God. And the Bible has only one sentence for people like that. It says, the fool has said in his heart there is no God, in Psalms 53 and verse 1. You see, God doesn't need to waste time with such people. God will leave enough of evidence of himself, that he is living, he is caring, and he is loving. So anyway, there were three of his friends there when God appeared to him. I mean, God is God. He can do anything he wants to do. Now, how did God appear to him? He appeared just like a man. He didn't know. But later on, he knew this was not man. It was God. There's a vivid story in the book of Genesis where God visits Abraham in a tent, and he saw three guests coming. He didn't know who they were. Anyway, prepared food and drink and treated them very well, and then they left to go on their journey. And out of the three, two were angels. They were going to visit Sodom and Gomorrah, because many reports about them had come. And the other person was the Lord himself. You know, he came like a man. And later on that Abraham realized that this was the Lord. And he pleaded, you know, whether he could save Sodom and Gomorrah, because his nephew went, that family, and he thought at least 50 righteous people should be living. There was really none. And that was an encounter. So here he says, I have heard about you with my ears, but now my eyes see you. So God is real. God is not a myth. God is not an imagination. God is not religion. God is the person who loves and cares and is concerned about you. I don't know what your present experience is. Maybe something close to Job's. You lost your job with this COVID-19. You lost your loved ones. You know, they shouldn't have died. They should have been living. But COVID, you know, stole their lives away. Your business is gone. You know, you wonder whether there's anything worth living for. We saw recently in Italy about this man who was a very rich man, a millionaire. All his family was gone. Parents, brothers, sisters, wife, children. And he had also got the disease. He could have died that way, but what he chose to do was he got onto the right on top of the building and he plunged to his death. You see, because no point living, no point. But when you have God in your life, the worst could happen to you. You don't lose your mind. You don't lose your senses. The Bible speaks about a peace that passeth all understanding. And that peace can guard your heart and your mind and give you soundness. So with all these things happening to Job, in his mind he was very sound. He repents here and he asked the Lord to forgive him for the foolish way he spoke. Then we read in verse 7, because there were those three friends there. And so it was after the Lord had spoken these words, that's verse 7, to Job, that the Lord said to Eliphaz the Temanite, my wrath is aroused against you and your two friends, for you have not spoken of me what was right as my servant Job has. You see, you can say you believe in God, but how do you represent him? You know, in difficult situations, you spoke about God, you told what a wonderful person, how he had blessed you, how he had prospered you, and God, for some unknown reason, allows you to lose your job, lose some family member, something disastrous to happen, and now how do you represent him? Do you curse him publicly? Do you say now there is no God just because that happened to you? How do you represent him? The Bible says you are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. Just because you had that experience doesn't mean that God became evil. God, you know, is non-existent now. He is there. He cares. He loves. He still loves. So he was angry. He says, I am angry with you. Did you know that God gets angry? He gets angry. But he's slow to anger and plenteous in mercy. God doesn't get angry for every little turn, every little thing you do. No. It's like getting angry with a three-year-old child for doing something to you and you start crying. You're not an adult if you cry. If you lose your temper with a three-year-old child for doing something, you're not even an adult. You're worse than that child. You see, so we are like that. You know, in our foolishness, we may do things, we may say things, and God doesn't get angry. If you say there is no God, he doesn't get angry for that. That's how you feel because of your circumstances. Not to say that's right and you should do it, no. But God, he's God. He understands. There are things that he won't bear. You know, he doesn't bear, he can't bear evil and wickedness. But he said that he was an honest man. He was upright. You know, he feared God and he shunned evil. You know, only when you fear God that you can shun evil. Otherwise, you run towards evil. You know, you want to come up the ladder by hook or by crook, whether right or wrong, doesn't matter. And people like that will not last long. All what they earn will go down the tube. But here he is, out of love, he's rebuking those friends who really came to console and comfort him. He said, "You did not represent me right. You didn't interpret me correctly. You didn't tell something that this man who is fallen will be consoled and comforted." You know, if you have nothing to say, better not to say anything. That might do good. But don't try to console and comfort somebody who has gone through some bereavement and say, maybe you'd have done something like this to somebody else and now you have got the return. Or maybe there is some secret sin in your life. Did God reveal that to you? No, he won't really reveal other people's sins to anyone. You know, what you don't know, don't talk about. That's good for you. So he was angry with these three men for talking things they didn't understand, they didn't know, but they came with the sole purpose of consoling and comforting and strengthening. You know, when they came first for 7 days, they didn't eat, they didn't drink, they just stared at this man. They couldn't believe. He was right on top of a mountain peak and now he's deep down in a valley, like a beggar, his body covered with sores, maggots falling off his, you know, body, you know. And then instead of consoling and comforting, they do something else. They sat in judgment to judge the man. Jesus said, "Do not judge, for you also will be judged." So he told, "I'll forgive you on one condition." And the condition was, if Job prays for you. That was as it is for Job also. But Job, being the man who he was, honest man, sincere man, God's, when he told, "If my servant Job prays for you, I will answer," it was not hard at all for Job to do that. He gladly prayed for his friends and asked God to forgive them. And then God forgave them. Now that's not here straight away for you to be seen or to read, but I'll tell you, there was another person standing there, a lady. Now she should have been judged more than everybody else, because that's Job's wife, Mrs. Job. When this happened to him, you know what she said? She said, "Do you still retain your faith in God? At least now curse God and die. No point. I lost all my 10 children. You're stinking now with all these wounds and maggots falling off your body. I will live alone. You curse God and die." And Job told, "You foolish woman, when everything was well with us, we praised God. So if it was good to receive good, it's also good to receive evil from God." But God didn't tell one word to her. Not a word. Not because she was right, but God understood the circumstances in which that woman was. Imagine you as a woman, you know, brought to this world some wonderful children, educated them, and they all die in an accident. Not one child is left, or in a bomb blast, or in some terrorist attack. You know, can you think, imagine your mental state at that point? So God, knowing that, didn't say one word to the lady and say, "I am angry with you too." No. In your weak moments, if you said, "There is no God, I don't think there's a God," I'm telling you, in his love and in his mercy, he will, you know, cover you. He will protect you. He will care for you. He won't get angry with mankind for things like that. And of course, the next thing we read, is God blessed Job's latter part twice as much. Everything he had became double, and he received another 10 children. After bearing 10 children in nowadays, and you might wonder, how can you bear another 10 children? But remember, they didn't live 70 years or 8 years. But they lived 800 years, 900 years. Job would have been living in that period of time. And he lived for many more years. And praise God, because God is faithful. So I'm presenting to you this same God who is today our God. As we walk on the face of this earth in the midst of much evil and much challenges, we don't know what kind of pandemic is next going to hit us, but don't worry. God is faithful. God cares and He understands. So I'll commit you into God's hand and ask Him to bless you. Even though it's Communion Sunday, this Sunday we will not have communion at this service because now our regular services have started and we will have communion at our local church. Father, I want to ask you to bless every single brother and sister or friend who is listening to me today. You know their innermost being, you know their hearts, you know their thoughts, you know the frustrations they are going through. Lord, sustain them. Like to Job, come, Lord. Come in some human form to show that you care and that you love. Lift them up from that miry clay. We commit them into your hands. In Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Good morning, church family. Just to take a look at this week's announcements, I want to remind you that church services have begun at church on Sundays, and for the English congregation, it is from 8:30 a.m. to 10 a.m. So just want to remind you that you can make it. Your masks and sanitizing of your hands is a must, but we would love to see you at church. And a few more announcements. As you come to church on Sunday, Children's Church is also happening at the same time, as well as is the teen service from 8:30 a.m. to 10 a.m. So your children and the teens can all be a part of these services as well. And during the week, we have some amazing opportunities for you to connect with us. On Tuesdays, the women's prayer is happening from 9:30 a.m. in the morning to 11 a.m. So anyone who wants to join can join. And also just want to remind you of a special prayer that is happening every Friday from 6 a.m. to 2 p.m. in the afternoon. And the second session goes on from 6 p.m. in the evening to 10 p.m. in the night. So I just want to remind you to be a part of this. And also care cells are happening throughout the week in your region, in your area. So do not miss out on this opportunity to connect with your church family through the week and on Sundays. See you next week, church. God bless you all.
As you listen to the word, I believe the Lord would have touched you. The Lord would have challenged you. The Lord would have spoken to you and me, definitely. So let's sing unto the Lord. There's a wonderful chorus. It says, He paid a debt He did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. Yes, friends, the Lord did everything on the cross where you and I don't have to pay, that He paid for us. Sing with me.
He paid a debt He did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. I needed someone to wash my sins away. And now I sing a brand new song. I could not pay.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Once again, we give you glory and honor. Hallelujah.